Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to this brand new video tutorial series in which I'll be showing you how to get the best possible image quality from your Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras. I'm kicking it off here on the Isle of Arran, and behind me you can see the ruins of Kildonan Castle here in Kildonan, which is on the south part of the island. I'm not going to be overly technical with this particular course. From the feedback I've had from my photographic blog and from emails from you, it appears that some of my content has been a little bit too technical for you. You really only want some practical advice on getting the best possible image quality from your Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras, and that's why I've designed this brand new course for you. I'll be looking at the key elements of an image which help to produce not only aesthetically pleasing images, but also are technically correct in terms of colour balance and exposure. Composition always springs to mind when you talk about good images, but a very close second is depth of field. What first appears to be a simple method of determining which part of an element of the image should be in focus actually becomes part of your great photographic toolkit to be producing great creative images. So whether you're looking for landscapes which have pin-sharp focus from the foreground right the way through to the background, or you're looking for portraits with a beautiful background bokeh, aperture becomes a key element in deciding how much depth of field is there in that image. Where composition allows you to create the visual balance within your image, the depth of field allows you to isolate and distinguish parts of the image that should be in focus. The aperture is an exciting control and should be probably your first technical consideration of how you're going to create your images. I know we can't dismiss shutter speed as it has its own particular advantages, but most photographers will tend to use aperture priority in terms of allowing them to select the amount of depth of field they want within their images. To the new user of camera and lenses, aperture seems to be a control which works back to front. We talk about having a large aperture, or we talk about having a small aperture. When we talk about having a large aperture, we mean a hole in the lens which is quite large. Looking at a manual lens, you can see that when the lens is wide open, the widest aperture the lens supports, we're using the smallest numbers. In this case, it's f2.8. When we stop down the lens, or we close down the lens to give us the smallest aperture, we're dealing with the bigger numbers like f16 or f22. Obviously, with Panasonic Lumix bridge cameras and the small sensors, we don't use apertures beyond f8, and the reason for that is something called diffraction limited resolution. And again, I'm not going to be too technical, but beyond f8 the camera becomes very soft and we wouldn't want to use those images. So f2.8 is the widest aperture we can use, and it's the one that creates the most shallow depth of field for those beautiful portraits where the subject is sharp but behind is out of focus. And especially if you're using a telephoto setting where you can stand the subject close to the camera but keep the background a fair distance away, you'll enhance the amount of background defocus or blur that you have in your picture. When we talk about aperture control, the aperture is the one which will determine depth of field. When the camera sets up into automatic mode, in which aperture control is a semi-automatic mode, if you fix the ISO, then the exposure is balanced by the camera by adjusting the shutter speed. Normally you'll keep the ISO at its lowest value, so in the case of the FZ 300, 330 and the FZ 200, you're going to be talking about ISO 100. With the FZ 1000, the lowest ISO is 125. So I do recommend that for all your photography, lock the camera down to its lowest minimum ISO. You're going to get the most sharpness out of that sensor at that point. You'll get what's called the most dynamic range, so there'll be more detail in the highlights and shadows. It allows you to have more of that dynamic range in your photograph. But more importantly, there's very little image noise. Noise is the greatest killer of image detail. So if you can use the base sensitivity of your camera, ISO 100 or 125, but there'll be very minimum noise in the image. So having locked the ISO at 100 or 125, and you've got the camera, and you're going to determine which aperture you use to give you the right depth of field, the camera will adjust the exposure by using the shutter speed. If we look at how this happens, we have the exposure triangle. And with the exposure triangle, we have the three components of an exposure. So we have ISO being the topmost, we have shutter speed on one side, and we've got aperture. If we adjust the ISO, we're increasing the camera sensitivity to light. The downside of that is we increase the amount of noise in the image. Shutter speed is the way we control the amount of subject motion blur. Some scenes we want to create a lot of subject motion blur. So for example, if we want to create a stream with the water being silky smooth, we'd use a long shutter speed to allow the camera to create that image over a longer period of time. If you wanted to freeze some action, such as sports photography, we use a very fast shutter speed and that kills the subject motion. If you're talking about the aperture, it controls the amount of depth of field. And as expressed earlier, if you've got a large aperture, you're using a very small depth of field. And conversely, a small aperture gives you the most amount of depth of field. If you determine that the amount of depth of field is a priority in your image, then you'll be using aperture priority mode. Or if you decide that subject motion blur, either more or less, is a priority, then you'll be using shutter priority mode of the camera. There is a mode in these cameras called the intelligent ISO mode. And if you use that mode, it tries to analyze if there's any subject motion occurring in the image. If there is, it will raise the ISO to enable a higher shutter speed to capture that image without subject motion blur. For some images it works and other images it doesn't. It's up to you really to determine whether it's for your type of photography. I haven't actually found the ISO to increment the shutter speed to such a point that it creates an image without subject motion, but it depends, as I've said before, on the type of image that you're shooting. So in the series itself, we'll be looking at composition, how to create the right aesthetics in an image, and then looking at the technical considerations of that image to create the best possible one in that situation. So in the next video, we'll be looking at, in particular, aperture priority mode and governing depth of field with the aperture control. So until the next video, thanks very much for watching. If you're a new viewer and you like the idea of this series, please do click the subscribe button, then you'll be notified in your subscription list when the second video in this series appears. So until my next video, thanks again for watching. Please do take care and I'll see you then. Goodbye for now.